in a process to help their workers to bypass this sort of intimidation process.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, of course, they asked me, they must find their children that were
incarcerated.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we then started the negotiation process with the chief, you know, some of the senior members of the police force, and they then helped Marty and MC and Anuri to find out, to help. They introduced the system
mm-hmm.
to make it easier for parents
mm-hmm.
to locate their children. So the negotiations...
So the police were happy to...
Yes, they were happy to accommodate us. There was no problem with that.
Mm-hmm. But why did they need you to do that? Why didn't they...
I think that it was part of a system in the past where they simply do their thing and don't think about the consequences. But once we brought the consequences to their notice,
mm-hmm.
they realized what were happening. But mm-hmm. let me also say this. It was done at such a large scale. The arrest was done at such a large scale that they did not have time to think, where must I locate this person or how must I manage the whole thing. It was a question of, it was so serious, they were burning black people at such a rate that the police felt they must get control over the areas as soon as possible.
Yeah.
You know? So then they started to introduce a mechanism to help parents to locate their children and mm-hmm. to make it easier for them to find mm-hmm. out. So mm-hmm. in that respect, the negotiations was helpful for them.
Yeah.
But then there was a huge uprising in Attridgeville. And the women there wanted to speak to me. They sent me a notice to Parliament. Please.
So how did they know how to get hold of you in Parliament?
Marty Meiring was the contact person.
Marty was
the contact there.
Yeah.
She was a member of contact, and she had the contact with the women in Attridgeville.
Okay.
So they sent a notice to me, to Parliament, and they said, please, dress you up nicely, like Esther in the Bible. We want to talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
And then you must dress you up nicely like Esther in the Bible. And go and tell our father in Parliament, that's P.W. Botha, what's happening to our lives. We believe he does not know what's going on.
Mm.
And we think we need someone to speak on our behalf of what's going on in Attridgeville. But then to go into Attridgeville at that stage of the state of emergency,
yeah.
We could not enter any black township. Any person, you had to have a permit to enter a black township unless you were living there,
mm-hmm.
you know, but to try to control the radical, so it, as member of parliament, I also had to get permission to enter Attridgeville. So I went to the Minister of Police.
Just in his office?
Yes, in his office. I had the access.
Sure.
And I asked to see the minister. And the minister knew. He was well aware of what I was doing at that stage. And his private secretary told me that the minister is not available. He cannot see me that day.
Was that a signal to you?
I was wondering what was happening. Was he not prepared to discuss what I was involved in at that stage? Or was he very busy? It's possible that he was very busy because it was at the height of this whole revolution.
Sure.
So I heard his staff making arrangements for him to fly up to Pretoria later that day, and I took note of the flight number. So I went down to the flight center, which were arranging all members of parliament's movements. And I made reservations for myself on that same plane. I was going to go back to Pretoria the next day, but so I decided to just move it forward to fly on the same plane as the Minister of Police,
mm-hmm.
Louis Le Grancy.
Mm-hmm.
So why on in the flight, I walked up to the first class where he was seated. And he could not chase me away there. And I took a seat across the aisle from him and I said, I need to talk to you. I want to have a permission to enter Attridgeville. And he said to me, don't bother me with this here. I say, you are making trouble now. What?
So it
what
sounds, just from no. that, it sounds like he was obviously not interested.
He was not interested in discussing this with me.
Trying to avoid this thing.
So he then said to me, don't talk to me about this. I said, listen, minister, you have to listen to what the women are saying.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked at me, and I think at that stage he decided, because I was not a troublemaker.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a person, I think, that they had a lot of trust in as a, because of my past, you know, where I've done a lot of very responsible and interesting projects. And they knew about that.
Yeah.
And he said to me, I'll talk to you later.
So you got no answer?
No, I got no answer. And I was very unhappy. But I went and I saw Marty and I told her, we cannot go in. I need permission to go in. They can come out. Marty said, we have to go in there. I want you to see the circumstances there.
No, she had access.
I beg yours? Yeah, Marty just ignored this. She just went in with the women, of course. She got
so
in the car.
So did they block you at the entrance of the township?
At that stage, I was not aware how they did this.
Okay.
I did not bother too much to find out how they manage entrance or not, you know.
Yeah.
But Marty just got in the car and went and saw them, you know. She also had a lot of guts. But not being involved in any position of responsibility, I mean, she was a journalist with a paper, and they would not bother.
Which paper was she with?
At that stage, she was a freelance, I think.
Okay.
She just
so as a journalist, sometimes you had a little more leeway to
yes,
move around.
Yes. But she was a very capable, capable journalist.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went back to Cape Town, and I was very unhappy about the fact that I could not get in to see the women.
Mm-hmm.
And the next Thursday at caucus, when the caucus was leaving, I waited for Le Grancy at the door. And when he saw me, he knew exactly what I was going to ask him again. I said, is it alweer jy?
So in a way trying to tell you
what is your problem? And I said, please minister, make it possible for me to see the women in Attridgeville. And then he said to his private secretary waiting for him, he said, help Rina and to make arrangements, call the chief the police in charge, the general in Pretoria, and tell them to allow Rina to go in. Okay, then I had permission and I flew back to Pretoria. And I said to Marty then, okay, make the arrangements. So the day that I got in the township, when I went in, it was very interesting.
Was it just a normal weekday?
It was a normal weekday.
Early in the day, late in the day?
It was early in the morning, about 10 or 9 o'clock, half past 9.
Mm-hmm.
When I went in, came to the entrance of Attridgeville, there was a car, a breakdown with lots of young people working on this car. And Marty then said to me, that is the security police. It's not a real breakdown. It's people, you know, it's a sort of a cover up. To watch out for to keep the peace, because peace was established to a certain point in that
area. So these
area.
Were all black guys.
They were black and white, and I then went in, and when I got to this house, it was a newly built house, a good house, and there were about 10 women sitting in a circle waiting for me. And the space in the lounge was a bit cramped.
Mm-hmm.
And Marty and myself sat down.
But when you arrived, was it peaceful outside?
Yes, dead peaceful, no violence. It was an ordinary summer, a winter day. I think it was in the winter, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And we went in and I was greeted very friendly by all the women. And we sat down and then a young woman, a beautiful woman, acted as the spokesperson. And it was funny that such a young person could be in charge of this meeting. I realized that this is not right. I mean, I know black people from when I was born in this country, and I know that seniority is based on years and, you know, your age and things like that. So I decided that the real leader of this group is not that woman, but she might be nominated to act as spokesman, so I alerted myself to find out who was the real leader, yeah. And then the discussion started and she said to me...
Why do you think she was, quote-unquote, appointed?
I think she was very verbal and she was very intelligent. And I think they had a lot of confidence in her.
So intellectually she muscled the others out of...
No, I think she was elected. She was she was nominated by the group to act as spokesperson because she was a competent speaker.
But it did not follow traditional procedure.
No, but they decided to nominate her. But that is democratic, you know, that she will act on their behalf. And then explain to me what the woman wants me to, what they want me to know. And then she said to me, the first thing they want to know, whether I got their message, that they expect me as their representative in Parliament. And that struck me between the eyes, that the woman, the black woman, owned me up. You know, they decided I could speak on their behalf.
Wow.
And that was a great moment because I realized that there's something politicians don't understand, and it is the bond between women, or men for that sake, for whatever purpose you get together, that you can form a bond, a strong bond.
Yeah.
And immediately that established a sort of a